supposed to be fun. Sometimes I'm up here and I'm, you know, real deep and theological and intellectual, and this is not going to be one of those Sundays. So, lucky you, right? And for the record, I was very, very tempted along the lines of this whole, how long ago is 30 years? I wanted to find the most horrible 80s gospel music video I could find and put that as the offertory. And fortunately for you all, I couldn't figure out how to capture it, find what I could capture and put it on there. So you all got to hear some contemporary stuff. And I guess you should be thankful for that, because I was ready to subject you to some Walter Hawkins or some Andre Crouch or some of that really, really excellent. You didn't think I knew who Walter Hawkins was, did you? But I've been thinking about this for the last, you know, couple of weeks since we knew we were going to do this. And rather than try to come up with some deep theological thing, I figured I would just stand up here for a few minutes. This will be short. This won't be the main focus of the service. And talk to you about how long 30 years actually is. You know, we throw that, you know, Pastor Bill and Miss Liz have been in ministry now for 30 years. You said it was August 10th of 87, that would have been? Yeah, okay, so we throw this word around 30 years, and we need to stop and take a moment and think about what that actually means. Well, even if you account for vacations and times off, that is about 1,500 Sundays. If Pastor Bill has kept his more or less the same order of services, it's about 8,000 worship songs. It's between 100 and 150 church dinners. And everybody laughs, because you know the church, you know, it's supposed to laugh. Don't pretend like you haven't been in the church for a while. You know, well, the church dinner raises the pastor's stress level a little bit, okay? All right, remember, I'm one of you all. I've been in the church for a little over 30 years myself, so I've been around the block, know how this thing works. So I can throw a bunch of numbers at you. Unfortunately, a lot of our good numbers were destroyed in the fire. I was going to come up with records of like how many baptisms and all that other, and weddings and so on and so forth, but unfortunately, in the fire, we lost a lot of those records. So we'll just have to say hundreds and hundreds as far as the weddings and baptisms and so on and so forth. I think the best way, though, to measure how long Bill and Liz and Molly have been faithful to this church is to talk about how different the world is now than it was in August of 1987 when they took this job. If you had turned on the news in 1987, you might have seen the President of the United States, Ronald Reagan, swearing off with world leaders, just like the President of the United States is squaring off with world leaders today. The difference is, President Reagan was up against a guy named Mikhail Gorbachev. Who remembers Gorbachev? And his buddy, the Ayatollah Khomeini. These were the characters on the world stage in 1987, and the young folks are just going, ooh. You know, let me help the young folks out. You know, there's this scary stuff in the news about North Korea possibly having a nuke that could hit the United States. I have bad news for you. We grew up with that. When I was in school, when I was about you guys' age, we were still doing nuclear attack drills. Where you see all the old folks are not, we were still hiding under our desks. Now, I was from up north. Nobody ever adequately explained to me why the Soviets would bother to waste a perfectly good nuke on Traverse City, Michigan. But we still did the thing. Hit up, the siren would go off, we'd hide under our desks, we'd run into the halls and lay down against the interior walls. We would practice for the Soviets destroying the world, okay? And the young folks are going, Soviets? That's some kind of space alien? Soviets? Who are they? Russians, yeah, okay. Technically incorrect, but you're not wrong because they call them Russian. You might have heard about, if you turned on the news in 1987, you would have seen this guy, you would have seen the great stock market crash of 1987. And then all the folks are nodding. When the Dow crashed to, are you ready for this? The Dow crashed to 1,738. It's about one-tenth the value it is today. The news would have told you about the big Iran-Contra scandal. Iraq was using chemical weapons on civilians. Terrorists were killing people with bombs in bus stations in places like Sri Lanka and Ireland. There was an active shooter event in England. Now, I'm using a term that we use now. That's a relatively new term. In 1987, we didn't call them active shooters when they just went in somewhere with a rifle and killed a bunch of people. They were just like nuts with guns. We didn't even have a name for it yet in 1987. It was just, oh my goodness, this guy killed a bunch of people. The big one I'm thinking of was in England. You know, they were just nuts with guns. And if you were a churchgoer, you might have been troubled by a very high-profile sex scandal involving a prominent televangelist by the name of Jim Baker. Oh, Jim Baker. If you had gone to the movies in 1987, you might have learned that Mel Gibson was a lethal weapon. Michael Douglas had a fatal attraction. Patrick Swayze was Dirty Dancing. And you might have been excited and maybe a little bit apprehensive about the new James Bond, Timothy Dalton. You know, he's talking about a new Bond now. Okay, we've been through this a couple of times, the trauma of a new Bond, you know. Or maybe Arnold Schwarzenegger would have told you to get to the chopper. This was 1987, and the young folks are just, oh my goodness. And we're all from another planet. I think it's worse. If you had turned on the TV in 1987, you might have been excited to find that Star Trek had a next generation. Oh my goodness, Star Trek had a next generation. Make it so. I am too. This is the Star Trek that I grew up with. You know, although I have since become an appreciator of the original series, so. And now we're about, what, like 4 series, 10 movies since then, you know, how many ever. I mean, it's still going strong. You might have learned when you turned on the TV that the house was full. That's been rebooted now just recently. Hollywood's apparently out of ideas, so they're stealing all of our old ones from the 80s. You would have seen one of the Cosby kids enter a different world. That happened in 1987. Who remembers the different? Oh, this actually, I thought this one was better than the Cosby Show, personally. If you had cable in 1987, who had cable in the late 80s? Okay, you might have had a whopping, what, about 25 channels, maybe? I remember Fraggle Rock. I didn't have cable myself. Both of my grandparents did, so it was kind of an event to watch cable, you know. The TV I grew up with had 7, 9, and sometimes you, depending on. I mean, up north, we only had 3 stations. You know, if the weather was just right, we would pick up the PBS station from Green Bay up north. We had 3 channels on a good day. But if you had cable, you had 25. That was a big deal. 25 channels. And if you had a satellite dish, it was the size of the Hugo. Did you also see old folks see what I just did to the young folks there? They have no idea what I'm even talking about. They have no idea. Hugo, what's that? You had a satellite dish, it was the size of a Hugo. If you had a satellite dish, it might have even been as big as an Oldsmobile. I'll help the young folks out. There's a Hugo. Anybody here actually own one? No? Okay. Oh, they were terrible. They were terrible. And there's your Oldsmobile. I bet you somebody in here has an Oldsmobile. I see some hands going up. We have an Oldsmobile. That's a 1987 Oldsmobile Delta 88. That was good stuff. Oh yeah. We were excited. If you saw an Oldsmobile Delta, Oldsmobile 88, you were excited. There it is. If you had one of those massive satellite dishes, I'm helping you out now. That was a satellite dish. You might have been astonished to find that MTV actually played music. Oh my goodness, they haven't done that in years. MTV played actually music. If you turned on MTV like I sometimes did when the cable was on and when the satellite dish was working right, you would have learned that Whitney Houston wanted to dance with somebody. Rick Astley was never going to give you up. You too still hadn't found what it was looking for. Nothing was going to stop Starship now. Who remembers Starship? I remember Starship. There we go. Fleetwood Mac was telling sweet little lies. And Michael Jackson. What was Michael Jackson in 1987? Anybody? Michael Jackson in 1987, he was bad. Michael Jackson was bad. And if you weren't careful, you'd get hit by a slew of criminals. Oh my God. All right, that one went by everybody. Okay. Took him a second. Oh, I remember that. And it gets worse, because if you were into what was then called contemporary Christian music, which was actually still kind of hard to find, like you had to go looking for it, like especially in a small town like I grew up, the Christian bookstore had a tiny little section in the back with some tapes in the midst of all the hymnals and everything like that. If you were into Christian music, you might have been excited to find out that Petra had a new lead singer in 1987. And a new sound. And this was kind of a big deal, you know. They went from this kind of soft sound to a more arena rock sound. And I remember this was controversial. This was a big deal, you know. Petra, a new lead singer, new sound. You might have Sandy Patty. She was sporting a hairdo that was probably today be considered an act of blasphemy. I swear, she used enough Aquanet to fill a foreign tempo. I mean, seriously, look at some of the videos. Everybody's talking about the Aquanet. This stuff was awesome. I mean, I was young and a male at the time, never used it. But if you watch the videos at the time, you will appreciate that you had women with hair out to here and it never moved. They would be dancing, and I'm serious, I watched music videos of the era. They would have hair out to here, all teased out, moving, and hair never moved. That stuff must have been like drywall cement, this Aquanet. It was awesome. It was some magical stuff. Although it could have been worse, these young ladies here could have been wearing parachute pants. Now, so for you old folks, before you start mocking young people and millennials, remember that we thought this was cool. All right, so just, you know, knock yourselves down a few much. And it's even better. If you were a cutting edge technological junkie in 1987, if you were cutting edge, if you had the money and you had the know-how and you had the will to be on top of the tech world, you might have gone to Radio Shack and purchased a brand new state-of-the-art IBM PS2. And if you were really rich, woo, I mean, this is cool. This was, ooh, that was good stuff. You had a 20 megahertz 8386 processor, 2 kilobytes of RAM, 2 kilobytes, oh, what can I do with 2 kilobytes? 1.44 megabyte 3.5 inch floppy drive, this one's got two of them. Remember those now? Remember those? Oh my God, floppy drives. 115 megabyte hard drive running DOS 3.3 for the low price. Are you ready for this? This is not adjusted for inflation. This is the actual MSRP of an IBM PS2 Model 80 in 1987, $10,995. That is what a computer, that's a good top of the line computer, what it costs. And that's not adjusted for inflation. What that means is that if you went to the Radio Shack and bought an IBM PS2 Model 80, it costs almost as much as your new Pontiac Potbelly. That is how much the technological world has changed. Where a good computer cost you as much as a car. And after you got in the Bonneville, yeah, you had to stop for gas on the way home with your new computer. It cost you about 85 cents a gallon. You could fill it up with gas. And you'd be so excited about your new computer because you're a tech junkie and you got your tech junkie friends that you wouldn't even wait to get home. You'd call your other techie friend from your $4,000 Motorola Dynatac cell phone. Again, that's not inflation adjusted. When this came out, it was $4,000. When you have correct for inflation, that's about $8,509 for your cell phone. And you wouldn't even care calling your friend because you were so excited about your new computer if it was a long distance call. They have no idea what I'm going to talk about. Long distance. Yeah, they will never understand the struggle. collect calls? Collect calls, yeah. Collect calls, yeah. Never made a collect call? Yeah, no. And then if you were young in my year, you came up with all kinds of ways around it. Anybody here ever like call their parents collect and pick them up and use like a phony baloney name as a code, and then they just reject the call and they knew that was the code to pick you up? Yeah, I would do that. You would call from the payphone in the school, the payphone in the school, and just give them a phony name like, Fred Flintstone or whatever, and when mom picked up the phone, that meant, oh, if Fred Flintstone tried to give you a collect call, that meant Matt needed to get picked up by baseball practice or whatever. That was a long time ago. That was what was going on when these two started ministering to this church. That was the world they entered, the ministry world that they entered. They entered the world of $4,000 stockbroker cell phones and Ayatollah Khomeini. And we're now at Facebook, Kim Jong-un, and everything else in between. And they're still here. Now, so what's my point with all this, okay? Yes, we can and should encourage them and congratulate them because that is awesome.
Yeah.
I don't even have words for that, But I do have some scriptures for you. I'm not going to get completely out of here without a Bible lesson. I'm just going to read them to start. The first one is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 12. Now, this is on the backside of what is sometimes called in the church the Hall of Fame of Faith. I'm not going to get into all that. I'm just going to read it to you, and then I'm going to come back to it a little bit. Hebrews, chapter 12, verse 1 says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith, for the joy he set before him, and he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners." You ever have any opposition from sinners, Pastor Bill? This last 30 years? No one ever opposed your ministry in any way, shape, or form, right? It was all just, never mind. Right. "Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." My second scripture is from the book of Philippians, chapter 2, starting in verse 14. And there Paul says, "Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life. And then Paul, will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain." Is ministry running? Is it laboring? Yeah, okay. I don't think I need to belabor that point. "But even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you." Now, where am I going with this? What does this have to do with 30 years of ministry? I picked those two scriptures because they're the kinds of things that Paul and the author of Hebrews said looking backwards. They looked back at Hebrews chapter 11, for example, and saw these tremendous people who did tremendous things for the ministry. Paul in Philippians 2 is, has been in ministry for a while. It's disputed exactly how and when it was written, but we know it was fairly late in his life. And he's looking back, and he uses words like being poured out like a drink offering and sacrifices. He talks about his life being poured out after surrendering to the Lord. When he looks back, these are the things that he's concerned about. He says to his people, "Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like the stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life." And then Paul, years and years of ministry, elsewhere in the scriptures he talks about all the suffering he'd been through, all the hard work he's done, the sleep he's lost, so on and so forth, says, "Do this so that I can boast that all that what I did was for nothing. Wasn't for nothing, excuse me. So, as I wrap this up, and we're going to bring some other people up here who are going to talk about, you know, Pastor Bill and Ms. Liz, they're going to give us some gifts of song and dance and do some other things. You know, as we thank the Mullies for their ministry, if you walk out of here and all you get is, boy, Bill and Liz, they're great people, aren't they? You will have completely swung and missed. Okay? They don't minister just so you can congratulate them about 30 years, yay, you know, here's a plaque or whatever. You know, they do it so that we would do this. So if you really, really want to honor 30 years of Pastor Bill and Miss Liz ministry, don't clap when they come up a little later. Don't walk out of here thinking they're great people. Don't even walk around telling other people, well, they're great people, which you should. But do this.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
This is how you honor their ministry. We're going to honor it in some other ways. Will you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, we ask your continued blessing upon this service and upon our pastor and his wife as they continue to faithfully minister to you, Father. But particularly, Father, now I ask that you would speak to each of us and lead us personally into the next step in our ministry and how we can honor the great cloud of witnesses. You know, the Mullies are among those witnesses, of course. But all of the people who have ministered to our lives, who have spoken into our lives, who have sown into our lives, Father, help us to honor them with our obedience to you, with our commitment to you, and with our relationship with you. And Father, we do that now. We place ourselves before you, and we ask for your help in this. In the tremendous name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
that center.
Amen. This next one is when I was a little girl, my grandmother taught me this song.
Amen.
And she was just, got me this song just to let me know how blessed I was. Because we take for granted a lot that we can walk, that we can talk, that we're in good health, that we can breathe. And we have to thank God for the little things every day. Because you never know. I was immobile for 3 months. I had sciatica in my back, and I couldn't walk anymore. And I had a thyroid problem, and God healed me from that. As she said, you don't know, and that's the name of the song. You just don't know how blessed you are.
Amen.
Can you walk?
Coming from
marriages, funerals. We all came, we took a God letters to the path where Pastor Bill was, and he was always there. Surely all of us can remember a particular situation that Pastor Bill was there and always encouraging. I myself have many stories to tell, but I just want to speak for all of us as a whole. There's never been a time that one of us is sick. We could look up, see Pastor Bill, live a marriage, he would counsel us and see things going on when we're living in sin. He'd encourage us. He'd marry us when they have you have death to lose a loved one. That's so hard. And when you come to a pastor like our pastor, I didn't want to focus on so much of the things that Pastor Bill has done for my family and everything, but that this is how we met Pastor. Each one of us had a situation, and we had different family, and a relative of Brian's that told us, well, we know a minister that will spare your child. And because we went everywhere, and there's a charge if you're not a member at the church, whatever. So I said, oh, really? Oh, okay. So we, long story, got in touch with Pastor Bill, and he told us that he would do it for us and everything. Well, that encouraged me. After the funeral, that's the type of man is this that can encourage just everyone. He was, it was a neighborhood church at that time, which it still is now. But and so I said, well, let me just go and see what type of church this is and everything. And I came here and met Pastor Bill and the First Lady and Mr. and Mr. Smith. I've been here ever since. So when I look out in the crowd and I see the young ones and my children, he encouraged me, then I turned around and encouraged my family. I've been trying to get some of them baptized for a long time. And so it all came. When I got here, Pastor Bill, he baptized, he married Ron and I, and then baptized my whole family, and one of them is, was about 5 months old when she got Christian, and she's here now. She's 14 years old. Then I witnessed to others about the goodness of Pastor Bill, a good girlfriend, and encouraged her. She came aboard, and then she, her family, and so it's just been a, it's been a beautiful journey, and all the things that we have learned from Pastor Bill and Sister Liz. So I want to say, you're giving all praise to God, so I just wanted to ask Pastor Bill, Sister Liz, could y'all stand up here just for a minute?
Amen.
Sister Liz, I want you to just, as we get, you stand behind him, don't just for a minute, won't you stand behind him?
Well, yeah, I understand. Pastor Bill, come up a little bit.
Okay. Stand behind him, okay. Behind every good man.
Yeah.
Know that he has that support. Now, Sister Liz, I want you to just put your arms around his waist. See, there you go. Now we can see the support and the help that God gives us to support Pastor Bill and all of you. We want to also thank Sister Liz for that. Now, Sister Liz, come and hold his hand side by side. See, God knew when he created man, he says, he looks lonesome. We're going to compliment him. I'm going to give him someone to compliment him, to be there for him. And then when he married me, he said, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health, better for worse.
Yes.
And so we want to give God the praise again. Pastor Bill, have you all been married?
This September 14th will be 43 years.
Wow. Always has led by example, and so we want to continue to follow, and he follows in Jesus' footsteps, and we want to continue to footstep followers as well. Mm-hmm. So ways that we can encourage Pastor Bill, it's little small things, like our green Bible.
Yes.
Okay. We see that sometimes on the ministry on TV, they say, this is my Bible. it is, I am what it says I am. Yeah. It's important that we have it now. Do me a favor, look at your neighbor and say, she already knows she's not talking about everyone. It's important that we bring out Bibles. Ms. Jenkins wants the pastor to feel baptized and stuff. Then we go to, we have classes, but we can get our own Bible. It's good to bring it to church when we come. I know the new days, like Matt said with the young ones, they know nothing about the main Bible. They got their iPhones, they got their pads and everything. So I see them with them, but this is the thing. Sometimes when we come, the minister that's speaking may not have his sermon on up here on the screen for us to see. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes we can come and for some reason it's not able to get on the screen or whatever. But if the pastor is speaking and we got our Bibles,
amen,
then we can go, we can look, we'll still have it. And we don't want to let our Bibles be crispy, clean with the parents don't.
Yeah.
We want to always take our little notes and things. And then if you got an iPhone, like my Randall, she has her phone. Some days she may be rushing to come to church and it's not charged up. Mm-hmm. But if you got that old Bible,
it's charged.
Then you can use it. It's charged and it's ready to go. So we also want to thank Ms. Jenkins, too, for, as you say, you've been here the whole gamut, and in the nursery, you can look out here and see Juan's reaction. And they're all grown up. It's been a lot of years, and I can just appreciate, we can appreciate, Pastor, all that you and Sister Dennis have done, and maybe continue to encourage you. How long are we going to be here? As long as we can serve. Here,
amen.
Your pastorship, we greatly appreciate you. We also want to give a special shout out to Ron, who does the YouTube ministry. When I hear sometimes we miss it, it's just a blessing to be able to get the sermon. That evening. Thank you for that. Thank you. Amen.
It's Canada.
You are.